I really tried to pare it down, so I hope that it's not disappointing to some of you, because there's so much data, and it's very hard, I think, to synthesize and summarize, and maybe not all the audience has the same starting point. Some of us are more technical and some less, so I hope it's the right balance of detail and synthesis. We'll start with just a little one slide of the survey methods, then discuss the country overview, the definitions of key indicators, which I will dwell on a little bit, because I think it's quite important that people understand what the indicators are, how they're collected, and what they mean. And then move into the results. So at first, we're gonna just, boom, look at the key indicators and analyze them a bit. And then we'll go through, as Michael mentioned, the UNICEF conceptual framework to put into context all the rest of the indicators that were collected. We have started to look at the raw data, which is, again, a huge undertaking. So there's some preliminary results from looking at the raw data to see, in terms of the two indicators of individual dietary diversity scores for women, or minimum dietary diversity for women, as well as the minimum acceptable diet for children, to look at what are some of the most significant factors in terms of the baseline study. That will be sort of the final results slide, and then I'll provide some conclusions and recommendations. In terms of the survey methods, as was mentioned already, there was a meeting last year, in July it was, in which the teams got together and really talked about what the methodology would be and what the indicators would be to have a standardized approach to the collection, which I think was an excellent way to proceed with trying to collect standardized information across such a wide range of country contexts and program contexts. There's a whole guideline that informs the sample size calculation and the methodology for collection of the indicators, the methodology for how you develop your sampling frame and select the sample. So this is really, again, very synthesized from that guidance. Dr. Sese, who's in the audience, was the one who prepared, so I'm sure if we have more questions, she's here also to help. The sample size calculation was 347. And in all of the NBS, I have to apologize if there's acronyms. I really tried to spell out the acronym every first time. You'll see NBS a few times. It means Nutrition Baseline Survey, okay? So NBS is Nutrition Baseline Survey. And in the Nutrition Baseline Surveys, the sample size ranged from 396 to 487. With the exception of India, as always already pointed out, very, very populous country, so that sample size was 800. What is super interesting, I think from a researcher perspective, is that there's data on about 4,700 women-child pairs. So this really represents a quite large body of data that people who are interested in research and different research questions around agriculture, nutrition, health, and care linkages would be very excited. I mean, this is really represents a lot of work and a lot of effort. So I would also say GIZ is to be commended for this data set. The selection criteria for the respondent was that the woman was of reproductive age. You might see that acronym. It's WRA, woman of reproductive age. So that's a woman between 15 and 49 years. And she had to have a child who was between 6 to 23 months of age. So the reason for selecting this is to be able to conform to the standard indicators that have been recommended by the United Nations. So there are certain standard indicators, and the program took the decision last year to follow those. So those age ranges are set, and some of the methodologies are set. What I think is interesting to say is 1,000 days is something that the World Bank has been promoting for about a decade, and that's because malnutrition, so changes in height for age of the child, which is called stunting, or changes in weight for age of the child, which is called underweight, they really dramatically fall between this period of 6 months to 23 months of age. So why is that? The child is being introduced to complementary feeding, which is foods other than breast milk. It's ideal that the child continues to breastfeed, but also what happens in development of a child? We have one right in back there. They start to crawl, they start to get their hands dirty, they start to put their fingers in their mouth. So they're exposed to a lot of disease as well. So there's just quite a lot of factors that lead to that being a very critical and vulnerable period. So a lot of nutritionists focus on this period of 6 to 23 months of age. And then also both for reasons of reproductive health. So women have are the ones who their health status and nutrition status in pregnancy, and lactation is quite important for the health of the infant. But as well, I wasn't able to be there, but I know Mark Hulf was there, Martina was there at the meeting last week at FAO when they were really looking at this indicator of minimum dietary diversity for women. And they can correct me, but what I've heard from colleagues who were there is that also the woman is just a vulnerable member of the household. Also is a good point of focus for us when we're looking at nutrition and how to improve nutrition. So even just focus on the woman is a good focus because we know that they're a vulnerable member, they suffer a lot from anemia. So it's good to have these benchmark data. What's happening with the woman and her diet? What's happening with the children who we know from numerous studies, very, very vulnerable period in life. If you don't grow properly during that period, you can be set back both developmentally, your growth, but as well as your economic potential. So it really has huge impact. So it's really great that the One World No Hunger program has decided to take on nutrition. So one other thing, maybe it will come in some other slides, but I'll get to it when I talk about the indicators. This is just the country overview. I think it's clear now that there's 11 countries in the One World No Hunger program for food and nutrition security. The nutrition baseline surveys were done on 10, and this shows you how they fall within Africa. So 4 countries in Western Africa, Mali, Burkina Faso, Togo, and Benin. 2 countries in Eastern Africa, Ethiopia and Kenya, and 2 in Southern Africa, Zambia and Malawi. Just, I won't read through the figures, I think that would be too time consuming, but you can have a look at the GDP per capita, which you know is an indicator of economically how the country is doing. But I think what is important to focus on, since this is about food and nutrition security, is the stunting level. So stunting is a nutrition indicator. It's based on the height for age of the child, and it's measured generally on children under 5 years of age. These data do not come from the baselines. They come from other surveys, the database on child growth of the World Health Organization that collects this information on stunting. But I think what's important to think about is that there's a threshold for the prevalence of stunting. If it's above 40%, then it's considered a severe public health problem. So you can just already sort of see very easily that these countries, many of them are above or close to that threshold of having a severe public health problem with stunting, one of the anthropometric indicators that's quite important for sustainable development goals. And the 2 countries in Asia are India and Cambodia. In general, economic growth has been quite high in India, but we call it sort of the India conundrum because stunting is very high still, 48%. So what's going on there? So it's great that these baselines can maybe shed some light on some of those questions, as well in Cambodia, 41%. So these are still areas really that have high levels of stunting, even though economically they might be succeeding more. I want to talk about the definitions of the key indicators. And what I think is really exciting about this data set is that these are 3 food-based indicators. And so the ties between agriculture interventions that you're trying to implement and education interventions about how to teach households and families to consume better food, more quality food, how nutrition education is really going to play out to succeed with these indicators is really important. So I think it's the first time that any data has been collected in such a wide range of countries with a robust sample size for the purposes also of monitoring development projects to improve food and nutrition security that have used this combination of these 3 indicators. So that's something really unique about this data set, I think, and really to be promoted. Some of the indicators are new, so it's also really good for people who are the United Nations organizations that are advocating these indicators to see how they work. So it's like a really nice case study of how it's going to work in the end in terms of how these indicators function vis-a-vis each other, but vis-a-vis also the program interventions. So Michael's already mentioned that the indicators, the first one is about women and their dietary diversity. There's 2 ways. It's the same method of data collection, but you can analyze that information in 2 ways. One is the individual dietary diversity score, which is an average, and the other is the minimum dietary diversity, which is a prevalence based on a threshold. The minimum acceptable diet is composed of two parts. I'll show you those two parts in other slides. And the food insecurity experience scale measured at household level, but keeping in mind reported by the woman who's responding on behalf of her experiences and her feelings about her household. So I think what's important is that there are three great food-based dietary indicators, and I think it's the first time we've seen them all in a baseline survey. So just a couple slides on definitions so we're all on the same page when we look at the results. The individual dietary diversity score for women is the sum of 10 food groups, and it's which food groups the woman consumed over the past 24 hours. Okay, so the IDDS, or individual dietary diversity score, is an average, so you'll see the results as they consume 3.1 or 3.5 food groups. The minimum dietary diversity for women is a relatively new indicator. There's guidelines that describe detail how to collect this indicator. It's the proportion of women 15 to 49 years of age who consume food items from at least 5 out of 10 defined food groups. Now, what's nice about this one, particularly for policy and advocacy, is you get a prevalence. So we get the prevalence of women who are above minimum dietary diversity. So that means that they had to consume 5 out of 10 standardized food groups. Now, what does that mean nutritionally? We've done a lot of validation studies, and the women who meet that bar, they consume 5 or more food groups out of these 10, they have a better probability of meeting their micronutrient adequacy. Okay, so they should be more sufficient in intakes of vitamin A, iron, zinc, and a range of 11 micronutrients that were part of that validation study. Just to give an idea, because sometimes it might not be so clear what we talk about in nutrition when we talk about food groups, these are the 10 food groups that form both the average score for the IDDS as well as form the cut point of 5 out of 10 food groups. So you can see that the first food group is staple foods, basically, grains, white roots and tubers, plantains. The second food group is pulses, beans, peas, and lentils, for example. The third food group is nuts and seeds. Groundnut is an important food in a lot of countries in Africa. Bambara groundnut as well. Dairy, quite obvious, so it includes yogurt as well as milk. Meat, poultry, and fish. Eggs, dark green leafy vegetables, other vitamin A-rich fruits and vegetables, other vegetables and other fruits. So I think also what's important to see here is it's unique in that it doesn't include foods that don't have micronutrient significance in the diet. So you don't see coffee and tea. We might want to know about coffee and tea consumption, but it doesn't go into this indicator because that would dilute what we're trying to measure, which is micronutrient adequacy. As well, you don't see sugar and other things like that. Okay? And the concept for the indicators for children is also very similar. So we start with the umbrella indicator, which is minimum acceptable diet. That's the proportion of children 6 to 23 months of age who receive the minimum acceptable diet. So minimum dietary diversity is, again, a proportion of children 6 to 23 months of age who receive 4 or more food groups out of 7. So you'll note right away the food groups are different. This is important to keep in mind, particularly if we're just trying to do direct comparison between women. Doesn't work so well. The interpretation is important, though. It's a proxy for adequate micronutrient density of foods and liquids other than breast milk. Okay, so they all have a nutritional meaning behind them. In this case, these were validated by the World Health Organization and UNICEF. Minimum meal frequency is the proportion of breastfed and non-breastfed children 6 to 23 months of age who receive solid, semi-solid, or soft food, minimum number of times per day or more. So that one's really important because of this very special age range, 6 to 23 months, the children have only a small stomach capacity. So their gastric capacity is quite limited. And if you are, as the household taking care of the child, assume the child can fill up at breakfast, lunch, and dinner, you're going to be getting it wrong because they just can't eat that much. So they need to eat 4 or 5 times a day, including being breastfed. So that's why we have that one of minimum meal frequency. It's different than for adults. And it's a proxy of energy intake from foods other than breast milk. The very newest indicator that's part of this suite of food-based indicators in the baselines is called the Food Insecurity Experience Scale. The H is to denote at household. So FAO has undertaken a lot of work on this indicator. They've just got results from a big Gallup poll in over 140 countries where they looked at the food insecurity experience of individuals, but it's also very valid to look at households. So this is what was done in this baseline, and two important indicators come out of this. One is the prevalence of experienced food insecurity at moderate or severe levels, the prevalence of food insecurity at severe levels. And what is the interpretation? It's the estimates the proportion of the population that faces difficulties in accessing food. And of course, then we're just looking here at moderate and severe food insecurity. Maybe people are less familiar with this, but it's why it's called an experience scale is because really it's based on the experience of the respondent. And so, for example, the woman who was responding in these 4,700 households would have been asked, during the last 4 weeks, was there a time when you or others in your household worried that you would run out of food because of lack of money or other resources? And it gets progressively worse. So like the fourth question is, was there a time in the past 4 weeks when you or others in your household had to skip a meal because there was not enough money or other resources? And then the last ones are really very severe. Was there a time in the past 4 weeks when you or others in your household were hungry but you didn't eat because there was not enough money or other resources for food? And was there a time in the last 4 weeks when you or others in your household went without eating for a whole day because of lack of money? So Michael already alluded to this. Obviously, you don't just take these questions, translate them directly into a language, and expect to hope for the best. You really have to do a lot of focus group interviews, and what does hungry mean? What does a meal mean? So that you really get a good nuanced translation. But I think there's quite a lot of assurances that that was done by the survey teams. And so that's great to have this indicator also as part of the baselines. Now, finally, coming to the results. So the team decided to structure the results. I think it's a nice and innovative and very good way to think of the results using the UNICEF conceptual framework. It's a framework that shows the underlying and immediate causes of nutritional status that lead to malnutrition. So at the very bottom, you have sort of the pillars. So I'm only going to present a few of them in the interest of time. But the bottom pillar, for example, are things like female education, but also the socio-political economic conditions and infrastructure of the country. But then really the underlying causes are really what this baseline hones in on. There's three. In shorthand, you can think of them as food, care, and health. So under food, we have availability and access to food. There's quite a few of these indicators in the survey. There's land access, there's number of crops that are grown and crop diversity, there's whether or not you're doing home gardening, there's whether or not you're keeping livestock, there's whether or not you have access to fruits. And then sometimes in some surveys, they chose to add questions about seasonality. In which season are you accessing fruits? Are you using fruits mainly for your own consumption, mainly for sale, for both own consumption? So there's quite a lot of nuanced differences. That's the other thing. In each of the baselines, some of them chose to focus on one or another type of indicator. So that's also very interesting that they had flexibility to add points of interest, but maintaining the standardization of certain of the key indicators. In terms of the care environment, it was both the mother's own knowledge, so the mother's knowledge primarily of how to feed the child and take care of the child during illness, but also very interestingly, and one of the first times I've seen this in baselines was whether or not there was a nutrition counseling structure in the village and whether or not the mother had received any nutrition counseling. So those are also quite interesting. The health services were really focusing on household hygiene. So does the household have soap? And if they do have soap, when do they use it? And hand washing behaviors. Also some of these larger infrastructure issues such as access to improved sanitation and access to improved water. And then the immediate causes that will lead to nutritional status are your food intake. So that's covered well. I think we explained already what those indicators are. And health status. So in terms of the health status, the indicators mainly collected prevalence of diarrhea. And in the interest of time, I don't think we're going to cover each and every one of these, but we'll see how many we get through. Now, myself, and I think others who are working with this set of data have been struggling a little bit of how to present it in a summarized way that can make sense to an audience. So in some cases, I peer-reviewed this method, but now you're really the first audience to have a look at how it really works. So it's kind of a dashboard method. Now, none of the cut points are statistically significant. That's something really to try and understand, because for minimum dietary diversity of women, the threshold of 5 out of 10 food groups, that's a really significant cut point. These cut points here, the prevalence being between 0 and 32%, or 33 to 66%, or 67 to 100%, that is really just to help give us a visual. So when we think about a stoplight, we think red, oh, I need to stop because something here is really not too good. Yellow, let's move with caution, it's getting a little bit better. And green would be, you know, that it is better. But certainly, it's not to make the point that if you see a green cell, that we think that that community or that indicator is okay. It's really just to summarize these numerous 10 countries and numerous indicators for a little bit for you, okay? So if there's questions on that at the end, I'd be happy to discuss them. But it's not a statistically meaningful cut point. It's only for visual categorization of the prevalence levels. And so boom, finally, here we go. Here are your main, we have the food insecurity experience scale, household level, moderate plus severe. The minimum acceptable diet, and the minimum dietary diversity of women. So and it goes according to those households experiencing the most moderate plus severe food insecurity, highest down to least experience of food insecurity. So at the top we see Kenya, and Kenya has 87% of the households said that they experienced food insecurity, moderate or severe. And these, I should say, have been globally standardized. So these numbers that you see here have undergone a very rigorous validation process where each item, so I showed you all the questions, those 8 questions is considered an item. It's gone through a RASH model where whether or not the response made sense was really analyzed according to 4 different statistical cut points. And then eventually it came to the best configuration of food insecurity experience for each of these countries. So it's very context specific, and then it was recalibrated to meet the global standards of the FAO food insecurity experience scale. So I'll also note, when you pick up your nutrition baseline surveys, you could see some different figures. That's not a mistake. It's that these have been subjected to the global standard, which changes them a bit, and these in the nutrition baseline have not. Okay. So just quickly, if we look at Kenya, for example, we see that things look pretty red, so not too good for any of the indicators. If we look at Malawi, it's not very good for their experience of food insecurity, but with minimum acceptable diet and minimum dietary diversity, it's there in the middle a little bit, some caution, but it's above 33%. And then Mali, interesting. So Mali, we have 55% of households experiencing food insecurity of moderate or severe level. Only 11% of infants met minimum acceptable diet, and only 8% of women met the threshold for minimum dietary diversity. And so I think what's interesting also, it's a little tough to make a summary of 10 countries and also try and tell the stories of context specific. So what I want to say is the goal for the program is to have achievements in particularly minimum acceptable diet and minimum dietary diversity for women, but how you get there is context specific and depends on the country. So I have a friend, as a nice little example, I think, I have a friend whose mother has a goal, Irish mom, to gather the family for Sunday lunch. That's her goal. I want to gather my family for Sunday lunch. How she gets there is, one's vegetarian, so she has to make vegetarian meal. One loves salmon, so she has to cook the salmon. One loves roast beef, so she has to cook the roast beef on the Sunday. So she makes 4 meals in order to get her family, which is her goal, to gather on Sunday. It's a little bit the same thing with looking at these, is we have a goal, which is that these indicators improve. But the way that you're going to get there really is going to take a lot of context-specific thinking and work and looking at the data. So I don't want to make it seem overly simplistic and throw out the context, which is why if we look at India, what's going on there? They don't respond to the food insecurity experience scale. Do I feel confident that that probably is reflecting a good reflection of how they felt about it? Yes, because it went through quite rigorous testing. Every single item, did it fit or not? If the item didn't fit, it was removed to get the best possible experience of food insecurity. So it's low. 18% of the population in India felt that they were moderately or severely food insecure. However, minimum acceptable diet was met by 18%, and minimum dietary diversity of women was met by 20%. So here we have this example of, we have the same goal, but maybe different ways to reach the goal. What's happening in India? Is it possible? I know there's difference of opinion, but is it possible that the public distribution system helps people, even if it's not implemented well, even there's so many problems, it helps them feel more food secure. And maybe they know if push comes to shove, they could get that service if they need it, right? So there's these different contextual factors that are important to bring in. Okay, so now just think back to the model of the UNICEF conceptual framework, because we'll try and go through some of the basic, then through underlying, and the immediate causes. So one of the basic factors is female education. This was a question in the baseline that said, what's the highest level of education you ever attended? The response would be none, zero, I never went to school. The next response would be, I did primary school, I did secondary school, or I did past secondary school. So this reflects anybody who said, I did primary school, even if it was only for 1 year, okay? So when you see the prevalence there of no schooling, some school, then you can take the opposite. So in Benin, 80% of the women have no school, not even first year of primary. And in Burkina Faso, 34% had some school. And you can see the differentiation. I hope it's a little bit helpful, the yellow to the green. Fascinating that in Kenya, even though it's a very underserved area, they all reported to have gone to a little bit of school. So two, I think, important things. Well, one is we see, again, context-specific, very vast range between 20% and 100% of women having some education. Just to put it in a little bit of context for international benchmarks, which was requested, the Millennium Development Goals, which are now closed, we're now on to Sustainable Development Goals, but the Millennium Development Goals ended in 2015. The goal for primary school attendance at that point was to have 60% of children enrolled in primary school. Well, we'll just do a little bit of extrapolation. The average age of the survey is about 25 years old, so in 2000, they were 15 years younger. And so this kind of, you know, is a little bit of reflection of where we got to with that goal. So what you wanted to see was 60%, and then what you do see is quite a few countries are falling short, even in this baseline survey. But keeping in mind, it was the woman who's between 15 and 49 years of old responding. But just to give an idea. The other thing that I think is important, just to set the scene, is a lot of the country programs are working on behavior change communication. So a lot of them want to work with groups of women or groups of families to improve their knowledge of how they feed the kids or their knowledge of how they take care of the children when they're ill. And if you have 20% of women in Benin that went to school, so 80% never, you really have to think very carefully about what type of message, what medium of behavior change communication is going to reach them. So I think it's really a good opportunity as you enter into the project managers come next week to think about these types of things. So what types of media will reach your populations in the best way, and what do we know about how to reach populations at very variable stages of education level? This one's quite interesting. This was about, do you have access to land? And in most of the populations, happily, they do have access to land. It's a big boost because then you can try and work on planting more fruit trees, maybe some home gardening, maybe an integrated homestead food production system that involves livestock, small poultry, small little ruminants, chickens, fruits and vegetables. What's striking here is that in Kenya, it's a very disenfranchised population. Part of it is pastoral primarily and part agro-pastoral, and they really don't have access to land. So if promoting home gardens is a big strategy, we'll have to think how we're going to do that if they don't have much access to land, right? These are the primary crops grown. And it just said, you know, what were the main crops grown, and there's also the average number of crops grown. And why I put this up is because a large part of the focus is working on food security and agriculture nutrition linkages, so it's just kind of interesting to see what the households are growing. Staple grains, and for the most part, they're growing those both as a means for sale, so income for the household, as well as for their own consumption. And then I think it's also kind of nice to see, like, for example, in Kenya, legume, 74% is growing some type of pulses. In Malawi, there's groundnuts being grown, also in Zambia. So these already are giving you a few little entry points to see they're growing it. Are the kids and women consuming it? And if not, let me investigate why not. There are also quite a large series of questions on home gardening, access to fruit, and livestock. So just to shake it up a bit, I just give the bullet points, but the final report that comes out will summarize everything, you know, in terms of all the figures. In India, Kenya, and Togo, 20% or fewer households had home gardens. So again, these are just to put it into the context for the program managers to think about how we're going to do the interventions. 1/3 or fewer of households had access to fruit in Ethiopia, India, Kenya, and Mali. And interestingly, 50% or more of all households keep livestock, except for in Malawi. All right, this is to show you the moderate and severe food insecurity experience scale as compared to the severe food insecurity experience scale. Again, keeping in mind that what's really nice about this project is these are two very new indicators. The prevalence of food insecurity experienced moderate plus severe, and the prevalence of food insecurity experienced at severe level. So, you know, hopefully, as we've said, this is, you know, a starting point, so one point in time, and obviously the goal is for that to improve, okay? So I think we've looked enough at the fact that Kenya and Malawi, Mali are both having a lot of moderate plus severe, but also quite high severe levels of food insecurity, whereas Ethiopia, Burkina Faso, India, they're not feeling as much moderate and severe or severe food insecurity. Interesting, again, to try and put things a little bit in context, is these results from Ethiopia, that they don't feel food insecure, are quite interesting because they have one of the lowest dietary diversity. So why is that? Why is that happening? Now, this is moving on in the UNICEF conceptual framework very briefly to talk about health. I chose to take the big indicators of access to adequate sanitation and access to safe drinking water. What's super interesting also, I think, about the baseline is that they looked at access to water in two seasons, so the dry season and the wet season, which has some very interesting results, depending on which country. But there's two bars that are important. So it's going back to those Millennium Development Goals of 2015. And the goal in 2015 was that 74% of the population in sub-Saharan Africa, so apologies to Cambodia and India, but it's for sub-Saharan Africa, the goal, was to have 74% of access to safe water. And you see that the top bar there, it's kind of bluish. A lot of the countries are achieving it. So even the report of the results of the Millennium Development Goals said there was great progress in achieving access to safe water. Whereas the next bar, which is access to safe sanitation, is in red. And the goal in 2015 was to have 62% of the population with access to safe sanitation. So when you look at the green bar, you see that in every country except for Burkina Faso, that it's quite below that goal that was set in 2000 to be met by 2015. So there's still quite some way to progress in terms of sanitation in nearly every project context. They're far away from that goal. And then those countries, for example, Kenya,
Togo, primarily, where you see large differences in access to water by season, that could be something that you want to bring up in a context-specific discussion when you're presenting these results to national stakeholders. What's going on with the difference in season? And then moving on to care, again, there were lots and lots of care questions that were asked, many, including how do you care for the child when they have diarrhea, and is that care adequate? But because the primary indicators are about diversification of the diet for the women and for the children and this minimum meal frequency for children, I took these two specific questions. So the way that the question was asked in the baseline surveys to the mother was, what should we do to prevent malnutrition in children? And then the mother got to respond. And then the enumerator needed to code her responses based on what she said. So here you see the prevalence of women, the percent of women who responded that we should give diverse food each day. So it's unprompted. She just knew it, and she said it spontaneously. We should give diverse food each day. And we should feed the child more frequently. So this would be an indication to you that that mother has had some education at some point in time. We don't know who it was from, health worker or her grandmother or her aunt or reading or hearing a message on the radio, that these are important things to do, and so she can repeat those messages. What's very interesting, I think, is what is happening in Kenya and Ethiopia. So the mothers have high knowledge of that it's important both to diversify, and in Kenya a little bit less so, the feed frequently. But in Ethiopia, they know it's important both to diversify and feed frequently, but they're not practicing it, okay? So minimum acceptable diet is really low. And so they know it, but they're not able to practice it. So that's a little bit different than the pattern that we see in all the other countries. In India, Benin, Togo, Malawi, Zambia, Burkina Faso, Cambodia, more or less the blue bar, minimum acceptable diet, is a little bit, you know, following a similar pattern as to the give diverse foods each day and feed frequency. So feed frequently, the knowledge of the mother. So I think it's two important things. One, explore what's happening in Kenya and Ethiopia. And the other thing is that it would look like from these baseline results that this really big focus that the program will have on behavior change communication could have a likely effect on minimum acceptable diet because of how we see the patterns are quite similar. And then I think, as has been, I'll just stress again, it's quite important to look at the channel of communication that you're going to pass the messages through. So finally, we get to the individual dietary diversity score for women. Again, that's the average. So it's the average number of food groups consumed out of 10 food groups. It's, again, going from Ethiopia, which was the lowest individual dietary diversity score for women, to Zambia, which was the highest. 3.1 means, on average, the women were consuming 3.1 food groups. And when we look at minimum dietary diversity for women, we see that 7% of women made the threshold for minimum dietary diversity, which is 5 food groups out of 10. All right? So you kind of see how the two indicators look in comparison to each other. A range of 3.1 to 4.7, and maybe the range for minimum dietary diversity from 6.8 to 57%. I think for me, I found the results to be pretty consistent, except for maybe in Cambodia, where the minimum dietary diversity was a little bit higher than I would expect looking at that average. So then we need to look more at the distribution and really look at the food groups that are being eaten. I did have a slide on the food groups, which if we have time, we, I think, could show, but it was cut out just for the sake of time. And then looking at dietary intake of children, this is comparing the umbrella indicator of minimum acceptable diet to minimum dietary diversity and minimum meal frequency. So what's quite interesting and jumps right out, at least when I observe the patterns, is that minimum meal frequency is higher almost in every country context than was minimum dietary diversity. So focusing on messages around and behaviors around changing diversification practices, I think, is very important if you want to influence MAD. Because MAD's not going to change if you don't change both of the indicators that are restricting meeting minimum acceptable diet. So you have to work on both, but in this case, it seems like dietary diversity is quite important to be worked on because it's much lower. Another thing, which would have been a little bit too much, I think, to try and disaggregate by breastfeeding status and age, but I'll preempt some of my concluding slides by saying age of the child is really important. So the children in the youngest age group, 6 to 11 months, have even less dietary diversity than the older children. It's quite logic, because as a mother, when you're starting to feed your child, you are very cautious and you're maybe afraid to feed too many different foods at once. So we definitely see that in that age group of 6 to 11 months, the dietary diversity is even lower. And so it would be important, I think, to analyze the data more deeply for each country context by those factors. So we did get the raw data sets. You know, it's one of those things that was fantastic and yet so much work. So some of the data sets are in French, some of the data sets are in English, some of the variable names were in French, some of the variable names in English, and so to run anything that's sort of standardized, you have to make all the variable names consistent, and it really was a large undertaking, and so I can't say enough that this is some preliminary results. But we do know the hypothesis that we want to test, and maybe you'll come up with more at the end of the seminar for us to test. But the first is that women's dietary diversity could be measured by the average or by the threshold of minimum dietary diversity for women. Will be higher for households that have more diverse agriculture production pattern and better knowledge of adequate nutrition. And then basically the same thing for the children. That minimum acceptable diet will be higher in those households that have more diversified agricultural production and a higher level of nutrition knowledge. So this is what we assumed what would be the findings. So when we look at the dietary diversity for women, we in fact were happy to see that in 9 out of the 10 countries, there is at least one and a maximum of 3 agriculture variables that were significant. So they had a significant effect on dietary diversity of the woman. Now, it's again, we can't say that the country context is really important. So it will differ by the country which of the variables came out to be significant. So it could be crop diversity. So remember that slide when I showed you so many percent grew maize, so many percent grew groundnuts, so many percent maybe grew soya. It's that crop diversity, one of the things that was significant. It's a dichotomous variable. You had a home garden, you didn't have a home garden. Dichotomous variable, you had access to fruit, you did not have access to fruit. And then some more complicated, you produced vegetables year-round versus just in one season when it's raining and you can irrigate. The number of vegetable diversity and the number of fruit diversity accessible, which is only available in a few of the baselines. So this is why these are preliminary and just to give an idea of, I think, the potential of the data sets for further analysis. Nutrition counseling was significant, but not in all countries, all right? So that's, I think, you know, cautionary news. And then other significant predictors, but again, very country specific, were if you achieve secondary education, this would be a small sample size in most of the countries, your geographic location, and by that means the district that you came from. There were some huge differences by district in the surveys. Ethnicity, and as we see in a lot of these data, higher income, more income sources was a significant predictor for better dietary diversity for women. For children, I don't think it's surprising, but agriculture factors weren't as predictive. So in only 5 out of 10 countries was there one and a max 2 of these agriculture factors that were significant. And really important is that the infant's age, so again, if we're looking at what's predicting minimum acceptable diet, the age of the child is quite important. So it might be that you go and we look more at the data, or next week when you're with the project management teams, you look at that a little bit carefully, because what that means is you need to start really early when the mother's starting to make porridges. How can we enrich that porridge with foods that you're comfortable adding or snacks that you're comfortable giving, fruits, nutrient-dense fruits, or some groundnut, or a piece of orange flesh sweet potato? How can we work on things that are comfortable for the women to give, affordable, feasible for them to give, between 6 and 11 months of age? Otherwise, your MAD will always sort of have difficulty to improve. Breastfeeding status, I mean, most of us who work in nutrition know that that needs to be continuously a message. So you should never have a message that at 6 months of age you can just start to feed the child foods. No, breastfeeding status is extremely important through up to 23 months of age. Okay, and then, yeah, interestingly, is an under five clinic child visits also were positively significant impact. And the district, same as with women. So some districts are more disenfranchised, you're in a different agricultural ecological zone, you're a different ethnicity, a different religion. It's hard to know, but that was one of the significant predictors. So in conclusion of these results, we're happy that they do seem to confirm that the hypothesis of relationship between improving ag production, and by that I don't just mean yield, but I mean really thinking about diversity of ag production through home gardens, through fruit production, through accessible livestock food for women and children to be able to consume, not just that we have livestock, but that people are able to eat it. It's not just for sale or controlled by men, are particularly important for women's dietary diversity. And then for the minimum acceptable diet, to see change in that indicator, you're going to need to focus a bit more on the youngest age of children, on breastfeeding, as well as the agriculture diversification. So I was asked to make some conclusions, and so they're very general conclusions, but I think it's quite clear in my interpretation of the indicators and having worked with these indicators a lot, that the areas that were chosen by the program really are very vulnerable. I mean, they're areas with either both high food insecurity and low dietary diversity of women and children, or some of those outliers in Ethiopia, India, where they reported less experience of food insecurity, but yet their dietary diversity is really not good. So focusing on dietary diversity of the women and minimum acceptable diet of the children seems very appropriate. And it also seems like the program interventions that I read about, which mainly are on agriculture, ag inputs, diversification, we might need to tweak a little bit, really focus on diversification of the production system, support to ag extension, support to health extension, behavior change communication with the mothers through cooking groups, women's groups. There's many different strategies, just like my Irish mom who had so many strategies to get her family together. So they differ on the country, but that in general, this philosophy, and then the last one, super important, is the multi-sectoral support. So support to scaling up nutrition bodies, support to multi-sectoral committees at district level, I think also very important. So a good match. And then when we think about impact pathways, I do find that they'll be quite plausible with the package of interventions to meet the objectives of the program. All right, so some general recommendations just to think about. One is, you know, we learned from some other programs of a similar nature. For example, the RAIN study, which is Realigning Agriculture for Improved Nutrition in Zambia, that not only do we need to have these baselines and inlines, what happened at time A, we did some interventions and now we're in time B, what happens in between is super important. So what they found in that impact evaluation was that the number of times that the woman goes or the family goes, the number of messages they receive, the frequency and intensity of the interventions is really important. It's often just missed out, and maybe there's a disconnect between research geeks who go in and do their baselines and say, okay, my job's done for 2 years, I'm gonna do my inline, and the people who are really on the ground who have to implement the project and need to understand that it's super important to say, which woman is coming, how often is she coming, and you know, how many messages is she receiving, through which channels, what activities is she participating in. Because if you don't have that, you're sort of a black box at the beginning and at the end. So that's really important, I think, as a general remark. In terms of availability and access to food, own production was a really big focus in the baseline surveys, but there was nothing on markets. So we don't know anything about the population's access to markets, how they use that as a strategy for their food security or their diversity. seasonal fluctuations, a few, like it was very interesting to see the access to water vary by season, but also access to other foods would be really interesting to know by season. It's quite important if you're trying to influence dietary diversity. I didn't present the results in a very detailed way, they'll be in the final report, but there was a divergence between households who claimed to have access to fruits and vegetables through wild collection of fruits or having fruits at homestead and having a home garden where they grew vegetables and their actual intakes. So what's going on with that? Why do we have access to fruit but we're not eating it? Neither the woman, neither the child. Very something to be looked into. In terms of care pillar, country-specific qualitative data is needed. We've gone through that a lot, I mean, particularly in Ethiopia and Kenya. What's going on? They had the knowledge, but they couldn't meet the practice. So what's happening with that? Most of the knowledge questions were based on maternal recall of these general topics. I just ask you, please tell me ways to prevent a child becoming malnourished. And you free recall what you think. But I think for the projects, if you're giving specific messages, particularly if you decide we have a lot of groundnut production, we're going to focus on enriching child's porridge with groundnut, I would want to be much more specific. So did you hear the message that you need to fortify porridge with groundnut? Yes or no? Did you practice that? Yes or no? I would try and get more specific with how I ask my questions. And a lot of the programs mention they'll do direct behavior change communication through women's groups, through cooking classes, this type of thing. Maybe one of them is doing positive deviance types of groups, which are all good formats of passing on messages. Others will train health or ag extension, so it's yet another channel. You train health or ag extension, we hope health ag extension passes the message and it makes a difference. Others wanted to use TV, radio, theater, other forms of the message. So it's, I think, very important to also assess the different channels of communication and how the messages were taken up and maybe which one is most effective. That would be really interesting. And then, you know, lastly, in terms of health and wash, there were lots and lots of household data on hygiene and diarrhea prevalence and how the woman takes care of child with diarrhea. But what struck me from when I really looked at the data was this very low access to safe sanitation. So in some ways, of course, household sanitation can improve. But if basically the population doesn't have access to toilets and they're using, you know, the bush, it's going to be very hard to really pull up, I think, your health conditions in general. So when you go and present these results at a national level, you can just say, you know, access to sanitation, while it might not be the focus of this GIZ project, seems to be a very important issue for the communities. Okay, and with that, thank you very much for your attention on a Friday afternoon.
Thank you very much, Gina, for, I think, a very comprehensive, dense, yet exciting presentation of the results from those 10 baseline surveys. And for absolutely keeping time, it is 3:30. So before we break for coffee, I think I would just say that from where we're coming from, I mean, the baselines had been completed. Those results were final. Now, the task you've taken up with your team was to kind of synthesize and to validate and to put into the international context and to look for consistency and the interesting bits, where is it not consistent and why, and what could it inform the program in terms of implementation. I think this is absolutely, I mean, it is a mission accomplished by this presentation today, yet we know the collaboration of GIZ and Biodiversity International is ongoing, and I can't help but be fascinated and looking forward to hear more from that in form of the written report later, and probably even a research publication coming out of this meta-analysis. So let me just remind us on two questions that are of particular importance to the global program. I know a lot of you might have technical or detailed questions on data and on how the baselines were done, and I think Gina already mentioned that we have Dr. Sesai here from University of Gießen with us, who can talk and answer questions on technical and methodological aspects. However, I think the Global Programs Coordination Unit is very interested in not only answering comprehensive questions on the methodology and approach, but on the way forward and moving, taking these main results we've heard about and turning them into a way forward on how to proceed in implementation. I think Gina has talked a lot about it has to look at country specific and the country packages and programs you're implementing. And I think this is where we would want, at least in the run-up of the discussion towards the end, I would like to frame the discussion a bit towards these very practical recommendations you'd given in the end of your presentation. So I would like to invite now four resource persons in front here. That would be Gina Kennedy herself, Michael Losner, Program Director of the Global Program, and Markov Maciek, who's doing the monitoring. Please join me here in front. And last but not least, Dr. Sesai from University of Gießen, from the Institute of Nutritional Sciences.
The data you have collected are very much of a qualitative nature. And so I think it must be quite difficult to do statistical analysis and do some testing and verify the data. Because if you want to use this data, what I find very impressive, the whole study, but you need as a baseline solid data. Or, this would be my second question, are you planning to do the survey again in the same countries at a later stage to gain more data to have a more solid base and also a possibility to check what you have learned now and what would be the difference in a certain time frame from now.
Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Emmy Hampel from the German Development Institute. Thank you, Gina. It was a very nice presentation. I was glued to the screen. I have three questions, but I will be very brief. I've noticed there's a lot of contrasts or conflict information with regards to the findings. So if we have, for example, a green in the FIES, but at the same time for the same country, a red for the MDD. And it happened not only once, but actually several times. And I know that we're talking about context, but for example, in Ethiopia, they had the lowest MDD and MAD, but better results than expected. And so could you just give like a little bit of information into the context so that this conflicting findings could be explained? The second question is about the hypothesis. I saw that there were only two hypotheses which were tested, and FIES was not tested. Are you having plans to also test FIES among the hypotheses? The third one is about policy recommendations. And when I look at the findings, we are talking about, the best results would be if they would have homestead, they would have vegetable diversity, they would have home gardens. It sounds to me that the policy approach would be to encourage a small is beautiful approach. So each having small farms, which is the case in Africa. But I know that agricultural intensification is one of the policy approaches of the German, perhaps not you will answer, but perhaps Herr Losner, that the German approach is also agricultural intensification as a way to reduce poverty and increase food security. So from a political approach, the findings show that small is beautiful, home gardening is the best way to increase, improve diet and nutrition, but from a political approach, we are supporting agricultural intensification as a way towards industrializing sub-Saharan Africa. So could you please comment on this? Thank you very much.
Yeah, my name is Barbara Schweiger. I'm head of the unit for agricultural policy and nutrition and food security here in GIZ. I'm not a specialist in that topic, but I have two questions. One would be, is it right that you've been measuring the indicators for nutrition after harvesting? So if you had measured it before, they would have been worse. Is this one of the right conclusions? And the other one would be rather for the monitoring. If we are measured with our indicators after 8 years, no, 6 years of implementation, I remember that within the CAP studies, the knowledge and application and practicing studies for measuring results, do you get again in touch with the same group of women you have now interviewed? How do you sort of compare these data then after such a long time of intervention with our project?
We start with, I think, Michael talking about the repetition of the surveys and the cycle of, will you do these surveys again?
Yeah. So the survey will be done again, I think, in 2019. We will repeat it, starting maybe end of 2018 and ending in 2019. Then we have a second survey 2 years after the first survey. So this is still an option and shall be decided as well with BMZ and depending on the term of the program.
Would you mind passing the mic then to Gina? There was also the question of whether the data is not pretty qualitative in nature. How do you see that?
Okay, thanks. No, that's an excellent question. So generally in terms of like broad umbrella methodology, qualitative methods are focus group discussions or key informant interviews. So those really are a certain type of methodology in which the sample wasn't selected in a representative way, right? So we're not talking about that type of data, and that's focus group discussion or key informant interview. We're really talking about data that was collected on a representative sample. So Dr. Sasse can add if she'd like, but there was a sample size calculated, it was multi-stage types of cluster sampling, randomized, so randomly selected villages, randomly selected respondents. The criteria was that it was a woman of reproductive age and that she had a child between 6 to 23 months of age. So right there you can say, okay, it's a quantitative methodology that was applied. Now your point is very correct that a lot of the questions are qualitative. So particularly, what's my experience of food insecurity? It's a qualitative style of question in a quantitative methodology. So how we analyze it is using the correct statistical methods, non-parametric statistics. What we presented on logistic regression is a good way to, you know, kind of look at data that's more qualitative in nature. But yes, that's a good point, and we'll apply the correct statistical methods in order to analyze this type of data that might not be, I guess you were thinking maybe of stunting, or I'm not sure what quantitative pieces of data you were thinking of, but it's quite common, these indicators that were collected in this baseline are quite common types of indicators that have been collected. Lots of them are dichotomous, right? Dichotomous variables where you met or didn't meet a threshold or, okay, thanks.
If you want to compare 10 or 11 data sets and from different countries, they're all very, very different again in geography, in all the kind of determinants, you have to find simple tools still which will allow us to compare after some time if there is an improvement. And definitely the stunting, if you want to go into quantitative measurements, wouldn't give us the results, because after 2 years, you might only measure your own error in measurements and not any significant change. So this is why it was very wise to maybe go for dietary diversity scores, etc. There was one question on the food insecurity experience scale and why there is this discrepancy. This scale looks more into calories, whether I am hungry. It doesn't really look into micronutrients. And this explains the difference. Because if you look, for example, into many countries, if you ask them if they're hungry, and they call the hungry season the one that their main staple food is not available. But if you look like what I did during my own PhD studies, I did 24-hour recalls over a period of 13 months, every month. And the so-called hungry season in Sierra Leone had the highest dietary diversity and the best micronutrients, because they went to the bush, they were trying to find other foods, and all of a sudden the food was diverse, whilst after the harvest, yeah, there's a lot of rice, etc., and a lot of palm oil maybe, but diversity is still low. So this explains greatly this discrepancy. So we can't really compare them. They are two different concepts. Yeah, and The other thing on diversity, what I experienced again is we can teach on dietary diversity. What I realized during a training in Liberia that people don't really know what we mean. Yeah, diverse, what does it mean? I can have five staples and it's still diverse for me because I have chosen five different, yeah? So what does it really mean? I think in our communication strategy we have to find other ways to get concepts across. And one more point here, which I was greatly missing, it's not part really of a baseline, that's the gender dimension. I was in Burundi this year doing an evaluation for WFP, and we as well asked beneficiaries whether they had received some kind of nutrition education, and they were able to tell me the messages, and then I said, well, please, can you put it into practice? No. Why? Oh, well, there was gender-based violence, they were thrown out of the household, back to the parents, they didn't have access to land. There are so many things, and they're all gender-based. So maybe this is one of the key issues that projects need to look into. And that means it's not just education for women and their children, because they are usually powerless, but it has to really include those barriers to change, like the grandmothers, mothers-in-law, their husbands, some opinion leaders, some religious leaders, etc. There are so many barriers to change, and if we don't get them right, we have a problem. So sorry, it was a bit more than on the diversity, etc. But I just felt it's important to talk about it.
Thank you. Markov, I know you would also want to add on this, but also go back to Barbara's question,
yeah,
isn't it?
Exactly. Yeah.
All right.
So like we already heard, this sampling represents our target population in the area. So this is the same what we will do also for the end line. We will not ask exactly the same woman, but also do the same kind of sampling so that we make sure that we get all this impact what we have on the area.
And before harvest, that was the other part of the question?
Yeah.
The results would have looked worse.
Exactly. Because we choose as a determinant for our timing, the harvest period for the MDDW, or the recommendation for the MDDW, which is recommended to do it 3 to 5 months afterwards, to have an average kind of diversity. So this is the same what we will do for the end line.
Okay.
But again, like I said, it's maybe not that the diversity would have been worse before the harvest for the reasons I have given you. Yeah. But the thing is, if you do it just after the harvest, then people really have too much. After about 5 months, then 3 to 5 months, you are back to normal. And then you will understand what people do under a kind of normality. But they don't have it, because after some time, then they go into their what they call hungry season, and then the pattern changes again. Now, with the methodology we have chosen, it's very easy and maybe simple to repeat it, even in a different season. We are not doing 24-hour recall, which is very, very laborious, but a very simple methodology, and we could be able to compare even seasonality if there is need.
Okay, just briefly back to Markov, but before we talk too much here, I would like to give the audience a chance back. However, there was this bit of testing the fees at household level with an hypothesis. Aimé had asked that. Could any one of you answer that one?
Yeah, it's very observant, so you were really paying attention. Good for you. this data, I sort of alluded to that fact that it was calibrated to the FAO standard to have a globally standardized prevalence of those two indicators, prevalence of food insecurity experience scale, severe plus moderate, and severe only. So that work, if you're interested, there's lots of manuals on how to do it. But every single country, the data for every single country had to be gone through many, many tests, and that just happened this week. So we didn't have enough analysts to include the fees in the logistic regression models, but we hope that that will be something that can be done. That was a
All
very
right,
good
you can, so you can read about it later, Emmy. Lastly, your question on the policy implication, yeah? The small solutions and the bigger picture. Michael, will you want to say something to that?
that would be a question for BMZ. No? But I would just say this is a possible interpretation, but I would not follow you. What I see from the baseline survey is that there is a correlation between agriculture production and the diversity, and among these agriculture production, among these techniques are, for example, these small-scale home gardens. So for me, it is a reconfirmation that when we promote home gardens in our program, what we do in many countries, there will be a positive impact. A more operational question is how it works with these home gardens, because it's not so easy, and this was not answered in the study here, in the baseline, how difficult is it to introduce it to, in a sustainable way and functional way, these home gardens. But to bring together industrial production versus small is beautiful, I think this is too much interpretation from these findings.
Thank you, Michael. I would like to pass on to Christabella.
Yeah, maybe we still could add, all the results which were presented here are specific for the region where the program is working. And for example, Kenya, this is the northern Kenya area. So it's not all over Kenya, and it's for sure a country has potential areas where we have different concept and has areas where we recommend for making nutrition security and diversity better, home gardens and so on. So this is also an aspect which is very important.
It's not only the context that it's one region in Kenya or one region in Cambodia, but then again, if we look into the analysis for each country, we can't generalize and say, well, we have to do everything now either in agricultural production. First of all, the projects GIZ has chosen, they have different specific things and they are just adding on a component. So we have to see what is feasible and then what is necessary. Yeah? It's a determinant analysis for each country or for each region. So to generalize a policy from this is maybe very difficult.
Thank you.
Yeah, thank you very much. We share, of course, the same objective as BMZ and GIZ to reduce hunger in the world. We have, as well, numerous interventions in this direction. Of course, we have also a massive pressure to demonstrate, in fact, that the intervention we fund are impacting on food security and more specifically on nutrition. So first of all, I would like to thank you and also share my appreciation for this exercise of for this baseline. Nutrition is a multi-sector issue, and that's the first, truly speaking, is the first study that look at the multi-sectorial of the nutrition problematic in all its different aspects. And you managed to demonstrate some correlation between some nutrition indicators and some specific sectors as agriculture as well as hygiene, or that's very impressive. Now we would like to know, as part of the commission, first of all, can we include as well some correlation with anthropometric indicators? Why you didn't take on board some of those indicators, stunting or acute malnutrition? It's mainly stunting. Second, is this baseline is applicable for 70 million euro project. Could this baseline be scalable at national levels? Or is it a one-shot opportunity for GIZ to check that indeed their intervention make an impact? So why don't you apply it to the overall project? As you mentioned, you have a 430 million euro into the pot. So why specifically for this component? now you have also different indicators. Some of them are new, as you mentioned, especially the food and security scaled indexed. You do not mention the MDDW, so the model of diversity for the MDDW indicator as a new indicator. So I do consider that you take it as a given, and that we can use these indicators as in all your future intervention. Would you recommend some of those indicators to include some of those indicators specifically, or you would recommend the whole package to have some to provide a picture of the impact of an intervention?
Okay.
So this of particular importance for us, because we would like to know if indeed we could, as European Union as well, try to enforce some part of the methodology of the evaluation, the whole package or part of it, and also should we consider including into our evaluation and monitoring exercise some specific indicators as the MDDW or the food and security scaled.
Thank you very much. Who else would want to pose a question? I'm afraid we'll only do a second round of questions. What else? Martina?
Take advantage of Gina being here to get her external perspective on whether you believe, Gina, that what the program has been doing now, which is of course very project specific, it's as Mrs. Vella reminded us now, it's specific to certain regions of these 11 countries or 10 countries by now. To what extent do you believe these the wealth of data and the wealth of information that has been gathered and that has been analyzed or is being analyzed right now can also inform national policies or even global policies? And if you believe that it would be useful to inform policy, how would you go about it?
Thank you, Martina. And we have then a second last but last question.
This is only a short one.
Could you introduce yourself?
Oh yeah, my name is Jürgen Fechter, KfW. Home gardening and agricultural production, I think we should be clearly separate that those two different things. Agricultural production is producing for selling, and home gardening is production for outdoor consumption. I think you made it right, but in one of your hypotheses there was agricultural production mentioned, and I thought maybe this is more home gardening what you meant.
All right, we take that with us.
Sorry, me again, Anton Mangsley. I have one question regarding the sustainability. You have developed an excellent methodology, and the question is, do you have any plans, for example, to discuss with FAO that they would take this methodology as an FAO methodology for the future, and also make sure that the data collected in these projects would remain to be available for the future? And because very often these projects, what they achieve, they have a certain lifetime and then everybody forgets about your data, for example. And this would be a role of FAO. And I'm a very practical man. This could be one of the projects, even in addition to your funds, funded by the German collaboration with FAO from the budget coming from the German Ministry of Agriculture. Because there is a portfolio, there is a budget, and this could be a way to encourage FAO to take responsibility and to maintain this data, and also encourage other donors to do similar studies in other countries, because you cannot do this in all the member countries of the FAO, for example.
I give it back to the podium, and probably we go back to the questions from the EU colleague who'd asked a bit about these anthropometrics. Why haven't you taken some on the baseline, and what do you think about the scalability to take the baselines nationwide and or to do it to all ZEVO packages?
I think for the first question, we didn't expect to have a measurable success on anthropomorphic data. We had a, when we have been commissioned with the program, we had a time for 3 years, and everybody knows that we can't achieve anything. And since we are an implementing agency and commissioned by the BMZ, we also have to also prove our impact. And for the anthropomorphic data, it was not possible. This is simple as it is. Yes. And yeah, I mean, I think you can't even with 5 years expect any impact in this one. When you run over 10 years or 12 years, then you can expect some improve.
Okay, there is debate about the time span needed.
Maybe to add on this, the 10 projects in the 10 countries, they have different priority interventions. And I think that they have to discuss the way forward from here. And if you look into the UNICEF model, yeah, impact comes from so many ends. And then later you cannot relate your own intervention, maybe in 2 or 3 areas, to the success up there, then you should have a control group. And if you want to measure, with some certainty, a minor difference, then your sample size is extraordinarily high, and then you have to ask yourself whether you want to spend more money on baselines. I mean, they are already expensive. Yeah, and if you want to increase the sample size, and you have to have more training and more calibration, and you have to make sure that this is really the impact from your intervention too, and this is the reason why it doesn't really make sense.
Thank you. I think that was an important clarification here.
And to answer your second question or your third, I don't know exactly. We tried to get all this experience back from all our coordinators who have done this service and also analyze it in a systematic approach. And what we get from the feedback, it was quite a efficient way to ask people. The time what we had per interview was less than an hour for all these questions. So it was quite successful to bring all these questions together, because you could also use some answers for some questions for other questions. So it was quite, I would say it was a really efficient way to ask this, and I'm not in the position to say if it's feasible for any other countries to pick it up, but it's an efficient way to get all this kind of information out.
Okay.
This combination of questions.
Thank you, Markov. Just keep the mic, because I suggest we work backwards now from this end to that end to the table. And there was another question on the feasibility to put the data to FAO and enter the debate. So I know you've been to FAO last week. Probably you would want to comment on the last bit.
Martina and myself, we went to the FAO because they asked for our experience. I think they have been really interested to get our knowledge, because no one has done this like we did it. And there was also the discussion about how we can feed our experience into their knowledge management. Because one point which was maybe not so much highlighted here, I think it's a really important point, the adaptation to the local context. The translation of a questionnaire to identify all these different foods which are eaten, and this kind of knowledge should be somehow gathered and saved and made available for everyone.
Nice to see it's doing the right thing, and it's so nice to see that something you've asked is already underway and happening.
So I can just repeat it, they're really interested, and we are also willing to share the data. We said when somebody's coming to us, we are really open to open our database also.
All right, thank you very much, Markov. Anything left for you to comment on? Probably on the question of the packaging of indicators to standard sets. I think that was also an EU question. But you don't have to. Then we have Ines stepping in briefly, please.
Thanks a lot for this question, actually, because we were discussing a lot which indicators to choose in the beginning. And we would have been happy if a standard package of indicators would have been recommended by the UN agencies, actually. That's actually what we were waiting for many years. So we went ahead, and I think at this point of time it would be difficult for us to give an answer to the question whether it should be the full package or a selection of the indicators. I think that should be probably an outcome, or we should follow up on this together with the UN agencies.
Okay, this one I would not like to get my, this one I would like you to stay probably behind when we close the session. If you have more specific questions, to also exchange contact details and continue. Because I also know you're sitting next to our colleague Maren, who will be part of that group organizing for a specific follow-up between GIZ, BMZ and the EU Commission on Nutrition and Indicators. And that has already been scheduled, right Maren? Or it's planned for even... Yeah. But it's going to take place most likely this year still. So there is already a bit of a group discussing that. So I would kindly request you to keep that. So back to the podium.
What is unique about the kind of indicators we have chosen is that they're really trying to, well, not follow all of the important issues on the UNICEF conceptual framework. If you look into the UN surveys, for example, you have WFP and FAO, they are concentrating on the food security side only. Then you have WHO and UNICEF, they are more in the middle and on the health side. And if you want to make a proper determinant analysis on your situation and you forget one of them, of course you will always find reasons that food security has a role to play or health has a role to play, but if you want to really have a feeling of what is maybe more important, you should really cover them all. And then you have to try to be simple in this, because otherwise the questionnaire will be too long and you can't really overwhelm people with all of this. That would be unethical. Martina had asked one question, and I think we have not really related ourselves to the question of national policies, whether this can really be infiltrated, sort of. I mean, let's have experience, first of all, I would say, in what we are doing and whether we are successful and whether this can be really, like in Kenya, be a kind of policy advice for the whole of Kenya, which is unlikely. But maybe in terms of approach, maybe. But I would say let's first of all get the work done and then see what can be really put into policy.
Right. Michael, I think you
that
add
depends.
On that one.
There are already in the baseline some indications that are usable for policy advice. For example, I remember this what you mentioned about sanitation. So this is a policy decision. We have only in Malawi is a very small sanitation program within our school feeding program. And we had already discussions with BMZ, this is too much investment because this is costly. Huh? So this would be a policy decision by policymakers in the country or by BMZ to say, okay, we want to make more in sanitation because there is a correlation to nutritional aspects and so on. Huh? So I think there are some, we have not finished, this is a first glance of the study, so there will be further discussions, and we even did not discuss it with BMZ, and unfortunately BMZ was not possible to attend the meeting today. Mm. But we will have this discussion, and finally this is then a discussion, the decision of BMZ and other organizations, but we only can advise.
Thank you, Michael. Before passing on to Gina, I would like to step in myself. Michael, you mentioned in the beginning when you presented the program, one indicator we didn't look at here today, and that is the one on alignment and harmonization. That is the one, so if you allow me to add, the program has an inbuilt scaling up to the policy level and aligning to and informing at country level and feeding into the sun movement at country level where applicable and so on and so forth. So I think we would be happy to look in midterm reviews already how far this has gone and what could carry that further would be my suggestion. Gina.
Yeah, okay. So just to answer your question, Martina, about the national and global policy implications, I mean, I think you and I have a shared experience of being at FAO. And as you know, there really was a lack of food-based indicators to measure anything about quality of diet. So for so long, there were the food security indicators of basically, you know, FAO's number of undernourishment. That, as Dr. Sasse was pointing out, that's, are you getting enough calories? So there was this big lack of what's happening with, you know, micronutrient adequacy from the diet.
So I think it's going a long way already at the global scale to say now at least every indicator is imperfect. So EU, there's no perfect indicator, but if you have a suite of indicators, you're better informing yourself. There's also no perfect harmonization. So why is FIES higher here, MAD is lower? You have to do some context-specific analysis. But I think it's a huge step forward at least to have these indicators available for international use, right? So that's a huge advantage and step forward. Now, the next huge advantage is that GIZ has put them in 10 countries. So we can now look at them and analyze them across 10 countries and learn from the experience of the program how they change and how they respond, because they are quite new. So you have a little bit of risk of you have to learn, but at the same time, I think it's a huge advantage. Having said that, FAO, as you probably know, has put in the food insecurity experience scale into 140 countries. So they already have done this at an they believe in it so much that they've done it in a internationally standardized, you know, with, through the Gallup poll. They've collected the information. I would imagine that that data from Gallup poll on 140 countries stimulates a lot more interest and a lot more take up in terms of baseline and so forth. So another thing for national level policy, I mean, first of all, it might be interesting, particularly for agriculture, to have the focus that's just coming, that it's not only quantity, but if we're going to reach the sustainable development goals, we need quality as well. Here, we have some indicators of quality, the dietary diversity of children, the dietary diversity of women, not all aspects of quality, but at least something that you can look at to see what's happening with the quality of diet for the population. Then what happens after that? It's important, okay. Then, all right, guess what? You're doing a national level survey, so maybe it's a demographic and health survey. Hey, you can collect these indicators on children, but you can also include a module for women. So I think that's where the point we are now of trying to stimulate interest at national. I think the interest is there on international level. You know, EU's interested, the United Nations is interested. So it's now getting national partners also interested. So it's a great point in time to say, we have this. You have this data now from 10 countries, and let's continue to observe how it works. So I do think that there's a lot of policy implications. Yeah.
Thank you very much. I think we've answered, partly at least, the question Crystal Weller put up front in terms of how to move on. We should know where we are. I think we've learned, at least I myself have learned a lot about where we are with these 10 baselines for the time being. I would like to thank the three of you and ask Michael to remain in front for three more minutes before we close. Thank you very much. Michael wanted to give some closing remarks, and I would just like to interview him a bit on this. And on your objective, has the afternoon informed you as the program director on interesting bits on how to proceed?
After having these studies.
Having the study and having the discussion today.
This is a simple question, but very difficult to answer. Because what I learned from the study is that there are so many information in that for me it's really too early to take already a conclusion. We will reinforce this or we will neglect this. I think this is really too early. I see that we are on the right way, that the interventions we are doing on the ground in the countries are on the right way, on the right track. Maybe we have to intensify some activities, some sectors, for example, wash sanitation, I think. And what is much more important is that we have with our project managers from the programs in the 10 countries or 11 countries to see with them what they do in their country, in their specific region, with their study. So.
Thank you. I think this is, leads me directly to my second question, because I know next week you will meet with all your program managers from the countries in a one-week workshop. My question would have been, you transport some of these messages to all your staff and program implementers, and there is no direction standard direction given on. Take this, where are they, these beautiful country baseline publications. Now, how to do it? It will be different in each country depending on the partner you work with, right?
Yeah, there will, from my point, there will be two steps. First, to encourage the project managers to have a look in their studies and to see what can we do. And the second will be we have our midterm review starting in October and running till February. And this is not a standard evaluation. It's a new approach, new method. And we want to see, okay, where we are, how was the conception at the beginning, because you remember yourself, we had a lot of pressure at the beginning to set up the program and to be on the ground, and there was not so much time to really see in detail what has to be done in this context and what has not to be done. So we will review this, and together with the results from the baseline, we will maybe readjust some country programs. And I mentioned as well that we will have another funding next year from BMZ, and this will play as well a role in readjusting the funding to countries.
Thank you very much. I find that personally very impressive that the program is allowed to do these midterm reviews pretty soon after start, so to say, to immediately have an opportunity to readjust, and that the readjustment and the evidence base produced will influence then the further funding. I think this is something we're all keen on observing. We hope we'll be invited again for a seminar, an afternoon like this today, because I also think a program like yours benefits from an interested audience and nutritionists from within Germany in different organizations as well as international scene to also give feedback and comments on this. And I think it is also part of the step in the collaboration with Gina and her team. So thank you very much, Michael, for organizing today. Thank you all for being here. And I wish you all a nice weekend. What I will take home is that if I want to have everybody on my Sunday table, I need to expand on my cooking skills all in one go. Thank you very much for this, and have a nice weekend.